Greetings. I hope and trust I do find you all, my dear friends. We are on our fifth installment on employment law. And as promised, we want to look at the last part of employment law and then roll over to consumer protection. Before we go into our study, a brief moment to pray together and thank the Lord for reuniting us once again. Kind and gracious Father in the heavens above, thank you, dear Lord, for the privilege of considering a study of the law, especially as far as terminating employment is concerned. Oh, dear Father, talk to us this morning. And above all, may you address even other areas of our lives that have nothing to do with academic pursuit and development. This has been our prayer of faith. Bless one and all in Jesus' name. Amen. My good friends, we are just going to look at how an employment contract may come to an end, and our particular emphasis, just to restate, is on the business side of it, not necessarily the personnel side of it or the employees' rights, as it were. These are going to be addressed here and there because they are unavoidable, but they are not primarily our interest. So the Labor Act lists the conditions under which a removal from the payroll would arise, and these are provided for in Section 13. And Section 13 is titled Wages and Benefits Upon Termination of Employment. And subsection 1 provides as follows: subject to this Act or any regulations made in terms of this Act, whether any person, paragraph A, is dismissed from his employment or his employment is otherwise terminated, B, resigns from his employment, or C, is incapacitated from performing his work, or D, dies, he or his estate, as the case may be, shall be entitled to the wages and benefits due to him up to the time of such dismissal, termination, resignation, incapacitation, or death, as the case may be, including benefits with respect to any outstanding vacation and notice period, medical aid, social security, and any pension. And the employer concerned shall pay such entitlements to such person or his estate, as the case may be, as soon as reasonably practicable after such event, and failure to do so shall constitute an unfair labor practice. Now, let us look at some of these items that have been detailed as avenues through which a contract of employment can come to an end. Number one is dismissed from his or her employment. So we're going to look at situations where someone is summarily dismissed. The employer would have taken this decision, and we're going to look at how this would happen. And then secondly, is dismissed from his employment or is otherwise terminated. So it might not necessarily be dismissal for cause, where you're terminated having gone through a disciplinary hearing and having been found guilty. You may be terminated, which is not necessarily a dismissal that follows a misconduct. And so we're going to look at these other various forms of termination that may arise on their own. We could have a scenario where an employee resigns. We're not going to look at this in detail. You're going to cover this in personnel law. But basically, when an employee resigns, you can't force them to continue to be at work. They no longer want to work for you. As long as they've given you the notice period, surely you should allow them to be on their way or renegotiate the terms so that they may continue to be with you. C, it would be a scenario where one is incapacitated. Incapacitation in this case would be in terms of Section 14, where someone is on an extended sick leave on the result of some medical condition, or they may have been injured at work and compensated, but they have not fully recovered. After the expiry of the first 90 days, leave on full pay, the salary may be revised to 50%, and when the next 90 days expire, the employee may be sent on unpaid leave in anticipation of them recovering. But should they not recover, then the employer may be left with no option but to consider terminating for incapacitation. So this is something that is arrived at after a longish period of assessment. And then D, dies. So when an employee dies, well, You do not have a scenario like, is it in the book of Kings, where the widow went to the prophet Elisha and said, you know, my husband had a debt, he's owing. My sons have to go and pay off as collateral. So they're going into slavery. But in this case, should an employee die, you cannot go seeking after his or her children or spouse to come in and fill in the gap and complete the task. Employment is a specific performance kind of a setup. So the one who has a duty to perform is the employee. When they die, that duty dies with them. But this would not ordinarily be the case when you get to the employer. That's what we're going to be looking at. That's our interest in going through this Labor Act. And what we may want to cover just in passing is what the estate shall be comprised of. Number one, you're going to be looking at the vacation that would have been outstanding at the time this employee was laid off. So the vacation being your typical annual leave days, you're supposed to add that into the estate of the deceased. And then, of course, the salaries that would have been outstanding would be applicable there. The notice period where it is applicable will need to be paid. And then the pensions will also be applicable there. So without much ado, let us move over to some of those items that would ordinarily affect the business and not so much the employee. So what would then lead to an enterprise striking an employee off its payroll? I want to address a misnomer, a misunderstanding. Most people would think once a company has been sold, that's the end of it. The new employer comes in with his own people. You have to find employment elsewhere. Your employer is no longer here. He's no longer the one running the show. But this is not the case in terms of the law. It's not automatic. There are certain procedures that will have to be followed in order to arrive at this particular setup. Let us consider Section 16 of the Labor Act. It provides as follows in subsection 1. Subject to this section, whenever any undertaking in which any persons are employed is alienated or transferred in any way whatsoever, the employment of such persons shall, unless otherwise lawfully terminated, be deemed to be transferred to the transferee of the undertaking on terms and conditions which are not less favorable than those which applied immediately before the transfer, and the continuity of employment of such employees shall be deemed not to have been interrupted. Now, let us just pause for a moment here. I want to stress that the alienation or the transfer of the undertaking, this is the company, the enterprise, does not immediately cut the umbilical cord. It does not. But what happens is the employees are deemed to have been transferred to the next employer unless they are lawfully terminated. So one has to ensure that when they are folding business and when they are buying business, if you do not check to make sure that the employees who were on board have been lawfully terminated, then you're going to be found to be responsible for these people. And what does this mean? What is the net effect of this? These people are still migrating onto your payroll. They're being carried over onto your payroll. And what are the conditions under which they are going to be carried over into your payroll? Subsection number 2. Nothing in subsection 1 shall be deemed, paragraph A, to prevent the employees concerned from being transferred on terms and conditions of employment which are more favorable to them than those which applied immediately before the transfer. So these employees can benefit by the transfer. And B, to prevent the employees concerned from agreeing to terms and conditions of employment which are in themselves otherwise legal and which shall be applicable on or after transfer, but which are less favorable than those which apply to them immediately before the transfer. Now, I want to underscore that the issue is agreeability. The employees must agree to conditions that are less favorable. Otherwise, the default status is that when they are transferred on the same conditions that existed before. but they are not barred from assuming or receiving terms and conditions that are more favorable. Neither are they restricted from reducing their terms and conditions should they agree to do so, which is, of course, unreasonable. We'd expect someone to write off a benefit that they used to enjoy and take less benefits. So to ensure that the employee would not commit suicide in this case, this section continues to provide that provided that rights to Social Security, pensions, gratuities, or other retirement benefits may be diminished by any such agreement without the prior written authority of the minister. So the minister must then go on to authorize where these employees are going to get less, and this will have an impact on their gratuities and pensions and the likes. Now let's look at C. To affect the rights of the employees concerned, which they could have enforced against the person who employed them immediately before the transfer, and such rights may be enforced against their employer or the person to whom the undertaking has been transferred, or against both such persons at any time prior to, on, or after the transfer. So I just want to end on C. You're going to go on to D. Now on C, you'll notice that you assume the liability should there have been any rights that may have been infringed upon by the previous employer. These employees might see that our current employer is good for nothing. So when they hear that the employer is about to sell the enterprise, guess what they will do? They will allow you to buy it and then wait for you to assume ownership and then come through and claim back pay for arrears and salaries. You'll have to pay those arrears. So the business person you are, you need to be alive to these problems that can arise. You need to be alive to the liabilities that you undertake, because remember, the liabilities attach to the enterprise and not to the directors. Yes, the directors are liable as a last resort, but primary liability rests with the entity. So if you assume ownership, you have taken the risk, and as the employer, you become fully liable. So this is what would happen in this case. And so before you think about automatically striking these people off your payroll, you want to make sure they have been terminated lawfully by their previous employer. If that is not done lawfully, guess what? They continue to be your employees even after the undertaking has been transferred. Now, let us move on to the five issues that I wish to address with you on how someone may be taken off the payroll. Number one, it is on the death of the employer. Now, this is a bit funny, but you'd have scenarios where some of us are thinking of entrepreneurship. We're going to be employers to some extent. So I would not want to address myself to multinational corporations because we are not in that space as yet. So being in a university setup, you want to look at that and say, in the event of my death, what would happen? Let's assume that your guardian or your sponsor is already running an enterprise of some sort. What would happen should your father die, should your mother die? Do you walk over to that restaurant and say, as you know, your employer is dead, guys? Just good. See ya. Just figure out what to do. Is that what the law provides for? No, not at all. Section 15 actually provides a section titled Death of Employer. Let us read what it provides for. Except where more favorable conditions have otherwise been provided for in the employment contract concerned, or in terms of any relevant enactment, including any regulations made in terms of this act, or in any agreement or determination made or given effect to in terms of any enactment. Now listen to this. A contract of employment between an employee and an employer who is an individual shall not be terminated on the death of the employer, but shall continue to have effect until the expiration of the period after which it would have terminated, had due notice of termination been given on the day on which the employer died. Let's pause for a moment here. So the employer need to have died. Secondly, there ought to have been a notice of termination issued as of that day when the employer died. And so the notice that would apply would be determined by the duration of the contract. So if you're on an open-ended contract or 2 years and above, 3 months contract notice would apply. And then below that, you'll need 2 months, and then 2 weeks, a month, and on and on and on. So this notice is something that must have been given. So it doesn't follow that as soon as someone dies and they're the employer, just lock up the place and the people go. It doesn't work that way. You must still issue notice. And secondly, reading on, and during such period, the employee shall be entitled to such wages and other benefits as provided for in the employment contract from the person legally representing the deceased employer in his capacity as such. So what we're looking at here is that your obligations to these employees subsist or continue to be for the next 3 months at most. So you cannot wiggle your way out and say, the employer is dead, there's nothing I can do. As long as you are the legal representative of the deceased employer, you have an obligation to pay. Let's move on to item number 2, dismissal. As far as dismissal is concerned, we're looking at dismissal for cause. This is someone who has been dismissed for a misconduct. This is provided for in section 12B. So section 12B, subsection 1, provides as follows. Every employee has the right not to be unfairly dismissed. Now, this is an interesting right. Now, this right, usually rights are positive. They create obligations on others. We did this in part 1. So when you have a right, someone has a duty, someone has an obligation not to interfere with the right that you hold. Now, this one is a right that is framed, it's a negative right. So it's not a right to do something. It's a right not to have things done to you. So it's an inverse right. So I have a right that limits you in terms of your actions. So what this right does is that it imposes a restraint. Yep, that's the word I was looking for. It imposes a restraint on the employer. So the employer cannot dismiss someone unlawfully. So that is the obligation that is placed upon the employee. And subsection 2 makes it clear. An employee is unfairly dismissed. A, if subject to subsection 3, the employer fails to show that he dismissed the employee in terms of an employment code. And then B, in the absence of an employment code, the employer shall comply with the model code. What we find here is that the burden of proof is on the employer. So if the employer fails to prove, so this is something that is also a bit skewed, because he who alleges ordinarily in terms of the law is the one with the burden of proof. So when the employee comes and says, I have been unfairly dismissed, the employee would then have to say, it is on these grounds, it is based on A, B, C, D. The burden of proof will immediately move to the employer. So after the allegation has been made and proven, the burden moves to the employer. But the bar that the employer has to prove is slightly higher than what the employee will have to prove. So what would the employer have to prove? That this dismissal was in compliance with the employment code. We're not going to go into the employment codes in this particular section. But generally what the employment codes provide for are basically that the person must be notified, they must receive their charge in writing, and it must be clear what they're being charged with. They must be given time to prepare a defense, to mount a defense against that allegation. Fourthly, they must be given an opportunity to call in witnesses to corroborate their testimony. And number 5, whoever charges them must appear in person so that they can put questions across to whoever charges them and their witnesses. And this particular person at number 6 should be able to address in mitigation, where they are going to submit to say, as far as my track record is concerned, discipline-wise, this is who I am, and these are my obligations that I stand to fail to meet should I lose this employment. So all in all, the employer must then sit down as a committee. Either it would be, we said in terms of the code of conduct. So you're going to have ordinarily codes of conduct are going to be having 50% representation from the employers and the employees and a chairperson on top. And in some scenarios, you're going to have just a disciplinarian who can preside over the case alone. When all this is done and the employee has been given the verdict, if they are not happy with it, there must be an appeals leeway for them to go by so that they can escalate the matter and exhaust the local remedies before the item is carried over into the labor court system, beginning at the NEC agents and the arbitrators or the labor offices. I'm sure you get the idea, but when you do your personal law, that is where you're going to look at that. Bottom line, the employer must ensure that they can prove that they dismissed in terms of an employment code. And if you don't have one, follow the National Code of Conduct. Now, let us go to item number 3, where this is deemed dismissal. The first one is, it is an actual unfair dismissal. If you cannot prove that it is tied to a code of conduct, it is unfair. And then if you should have these other scenarios arise, it shall be deemed to be unfair. And a section, subsection number 3, an employee is deemed to have been unfairly dismissed. A, if the employee terminated the contract of employment with or without notice because the employer deliberately made continued employment intolerable for the employee. So what we're looking at here is now constructive dismissal. That is the term that is used to define what happens here. So number one, you need to prove that it was intentional. Number two, you will need to prove that it made the environment intolerable. If you prove these two conditions, it matters not whether you gave notice before you left or you just upped and left without even giving notice. It still boils down to constructive dismissal. And then number two, if on termination of an employment contract of fixed duration, the employee, one, had a legitimate expectation of being re-engaged. Two, another person was engaged instead of the employee. So what we're looking at here is your fixed contract will run for a year or so. Now, based on your performance, let's say you do 1 year, the contract is renewed second time, third time, you'll get this predominantly in the non-governmental organizations. And then based on your performance, you begin to notice a trend and you anticipating this is going to be renewed. And then come at the end, someone else is engaged and you're sidestepped. So based on that trend, you would have expected that this would always apply. So you can go on and claim unfair labor dismissal. And then let's look at item number 3. So what have we covered so far? We've covered death. Number 2, we've covered dismissal. Now we are at retrenchment. This one is a topical one. You'll find this at section 12C. Subsection 1 provides, an employer who wishes to retrench any one or more employees shall. So what we're looking at here is, these are conditions that would apply to every employee in a sense. In the past, if you were to retrench less than 5, you could do that within. But now these conditions apply in the case of every employee. And subsection A provides, give written notice of his or her intention. Notice this. Every time there is an action in the workplace, notice must be given. We did look at section 104 in the renegotiation phase, and we said there is a need, even when an employee is about to go on a strike, he's supposed to give notice, 14 days notice. And you will notice that the employer, when he's about to retrench, he must also give notice. And to whom does he give this notice? Look at item 1, to the Works Council established by the undertaking. So the Works Council is a combination of workers' committee and employers' representatives in a similar representation. 2, if there is no Works Council established for the undertaking, or if a majority of the employees concerned agree to such a course to the Employment Council established for the undertaking or industry. Now, here's something that is interesting here. As we read this, I just want to point out something. You'll notice that there are two legs in this particular provision. If there is no works council established for the undertaking, or if the majority of the employees concerned agree to such a course of So, condition number one, if you do not have a works council, what will you do? You go to the employment council. Or option number two, if the employees agree, so the use of the alternative they without the conjunctive and does not necessarily mean you should always agree with the employees. I hope this makes sense. You do not necessarily have to agree. You may give notice they do not agree. You still go on to the employment council. It does not mean when an employee says, I do not agree to be retrenched, that the process dies there. No, it doesn't work that way. So if they do not agree, you still go on and give notice to the works council. And then number three, if there is no works council or employment council for the undertaking concerned, to the retrenchment board. And in such event, any reference to this section to the performance of functions by a works council or employment council shall be construed as reference to the retrenchment board, on and on and on. Now, B, provide, this is what you shall finish, the works council, employment council, or the retrenchment board, as the case may be, with details of every employee whom the employer wishes to retrench and of the reasons for the proposed retrenchment. So, section B is you must give details of these employees and the reasons why you seek to retrench those particular employees. What have you used? Have you used LIFO or FIFO? Usually from accounting, okay? LIFO, last in, first out. FIFO, first in, first out. You're going to look at years of service. The years of service basically come down to LIFO, last in, first out. You're going to look at structurally to say we are thinning this particular section. We're rendering this position redundant. Those are the reasons that you need to give. And then lastly, at C, send a copy of the notice to the retrenchment board. So if you have given your correspondence to the employment council, you still need to send a notice to the retrenchment board. And then a copy of that to the retrenchment board. And then subsection 2, unless better terms are agreed between the employer and employees concerned or their representatives, a package, hereafter called the minimum retrenchment package of not less than 1 month's salary or wages for every 2 years of service as an employee, or the equivalent lesser proportion of service shall be paid by the employer as compensation for loss of employment, whether the loss of employment is occasioned by retrenchment or by virtue of termination of employment pursuant to section 12.4A, paragraphs A, B, or C. And this shall be done no later than the date when the notice of termination of employment takes effect. So what we notice here is there is a retrenchment package that is already put in. This is a minimum. So it does not necessarily mean it is a must. It does not mean it's a copy and paste. You still have to negotiate, but your negotiations will not go below this. So it does not necessarily mean every time the employee must accept the offer because you have just plucked it from there. You still have a duty to negotiate in good faith. So when you're negotiating in good faith, it does not necessarily mean you're going to limit the retrenchment package to just the dollar aspect. So you could have some scenarios where some entities would say, we're retrenching you, but the car that you've been using, you can have it. Laptop you've been using, you can have it. And set out the conditions on how you're going to get those things. So it does not necessarily mean this is all that an employee should get. I hope this makes sense to the business person. Of course, the reason why you'll be retrenching ordinarily is because you are not financially able to pull on the weight. So you might not be able to cover some of these expenses, so to say. But bottom line, what we should understand is that for every 2 years of work, an employee must be paid a month's salary, or for every month of work, an employee must be paid half a month. That would be a fortnight's salary. So you could simply say years worked times 0.5. That should generally give you your retrenchment package with which move with much ease. Or option number two, you simply say years worked divided by 0.5. That would almost get you to the same answer. And then multiply that by your monthly salary. That will almost get you to the same answer. All right, so here's the other thing. Where an employer alleges, now we're at subsection three, where an employer alleges financial incapacity and consequent inability to pay the minimum retrenchment package timely or at all, the employer shall apply in writing to be exempted from paying the full minimum retrenchment package or any part of it to A, the employment council established for the undertaking, or B, if there is no employment council for their undertaking concerned, to the retrenchment board. And when this application is being made, I want you to take note, when we looked at collective bargaining, we said in the event that an employer cannot pay, an employer was supposed to apply to the employment council so as to be exempted. And what was the condition for it to be exempted? The employer was supposed to give proof of the inability to pay. Now listen to what happens here at section number four. But before we get there, this application should be responded to within 14 days of receipt, and failure to do so, it shall be deemed to have been granted. What I loved about this is it forces some efficiency onto the decision makers. You know, there's some scenarios where you come through and someone just puts you on ice. They are not attending to your issue. They're just doing nothing about it because they know you have nowhere else to go. You will wait for them. But, you know, hands up, heads off to the crafters of this act, because they have forced the presiding officers to ensure that they do things timelessly. They do things timelessly. And then let's go to subsection four. And considering its response to a request for exemption in terms of subsection three, the Employment Council or Retrenchment Board shall, listen to paragraph A, where the employer alleges complete inability to pay the minimum retrenchment package, be entitled to demand and receive such proof as it considers requisite to satisfy itself that the employer is so unable. And if so unable on the date when the notice of termination of employment takes effect, may propose to the employer a scheme to pay the minimum retrenchment package for installments over a period of time. Now, here's one thing that I found interesting here. You'll need to prove your inability to pay. And even when you are unable to pay either totally, or you're not able to pay in installments. I mean, you're not able to pay totally. You'll be pushed towards paying in installments. If you're not able to pay in installments, you're going to find this as you read on. You'll be pushed towards considering measures to avoid retrenchment. So it would appear the best course of action for the business person is to start with the measures to avoid retrenchment, and then work your way to the actual retrenchment. Do not go for the retrenchment first, because you'll be pushed down, especially if you're going to get to retrenchment and you can't pay anything. They'll force you to installments. If you can't cover it in installments, they'll force you to measures to avoid retrenchment. We are not going to consider those for now. But what they basically provide is where people would come in for half the time, and they can work for half a day, or they can work certain days a week, or they can work certain months, and other months they're out. But bottom line, take note, you cannot have a scenario where an employee goes for a month without a salary. They cannot go for a whole month without work. So you must at least provide work within a month so that these people can continue to gain a living out of that. So these are the measures to avoid retrenchment that you ultimately be forced towards. But bottom line, you'd want to take note that your obligations are such that you're going to have to pay the minimum retrenchment package, which is 1 month salary for every 2 years worked. That one you cannot escape as a minimum. Let us look at item number four. On notice, Now, having established that all these issues are retrenchment issues, so when you get to the notice aspect, the Labor Amendment Act 2015, Section 12 and Subsection 4, Paragraph B, provides as follows. When an employee is given notice of termination of contract in terms of Subsection 4A, and such employee is employed under a contract without limitation of time, the provision of Section 12C shall apply with regards to compensation for loss of employment. So on this one, you remember there used to be a common law position that an employer could just give you notice and say, I have no interest in working with you anymore. So in 3 months' time, let's part ways. This is the Zuba case that made some storm in 2015, resulting in the mass notices that were given to employees. This is what actually led to the Labor Amendment Act, which is the one I've just read. So what this act was addressing was a scenario where employers just offloaded employees onto the street en masse because they wanted to fire them using the notice provision, which was the common law position. So this was then codified, and a codification of the common law generally supersedes what the provision would have been back then. So what this now means is that when you want to terminate someone on notice, you need to compensate that person for the loss of employment, provided this person was on a contract without limit, on a permanent contract. So you are not going to use this in the context of someone who is on a fixed contract. It would not ordinarily apply there because it says a contract without limitation of time. So for someone who's on a fixed contract, it would not apply. So what then happens is this particular person is going to be entitled to compensation for loss of employment, but you are not going to give notice to someone that you're dismissing. So because the person who's being summarily dismissed is not being told, you've stolen $10,000 from the cash box, we are hereby notifying you that you're going to be dismissed 3 months from now. As soon as you go through the process, the hearing process, the termination is with immediate effect. So when that is done, there is nothing else that can happen thereafter. The person just has to go. So when you now come to the issue of someone who has been given notice to say, now you have to be terminated. When this person is being terminated, they have lost employment that they did not anticipate they were going to lose anytime soon. And because of that, they are now entitled to that compensation for loss of employment. And that same 1 month for every 2 years worked is going to apply in this case. And the other item that you're going to find as a basis of removing someone from the payroll, it is on grounds of retirement. Someone has reached a retirement age. Now, it is so easy for us to say, what is the retirement age? Someone would say, according to the NASA provisions, when someone is 55 and they're doing arduous work, they can retire. If they're 60 years, they can go on retirement as an ordinary retirement age, or late retirement would be at 65 years. But you'll need to notice that the NASA provision is for the pension fund. It might not necessarily be for employment. So there is a need for this particular aspect to be spelled out in a contract of employment. And why should it be spelled out in a contract of employment? Contract of employment. This was discussed in Meshack Mvumbi versus City of Harare. This was a Supreme Court decision, case number 64 of 2018. So what happened in this case? There was an employee was employed sometime in the 80s, and he rose through the ranks. When he started off, the statutory instrument that applied provided for a retirement age at 65. And then around 2012, thereabout, another statutory instrument came into effect, which provided for retirement at 60 years of age. This gentleman, upon reaching 60 years, the employer says, my friend, it has been good doing business with you. You have done your 60 years. of age proceed to retirement. So this gentleman says, no, I must be given the option to go up to 65 because I was employed during the time when they were 65 and all that and all that. And now somehow, they ultimately gravitated towards making the assumption that the pension fund that he was the city of Harare contributes to mandates the retirement age at 60 years. So they go, these guys go on to say, therefore, 60 years ought to be the retirement age by which all employees are going to retire because the pension fund provides for 60 years. And this has not changed. It has always been 60 years. But in as much as the statutory instrument has fluctuated over over time between 65 and 60, the pension fund has been consistent. So you must have known that you are retiring at 60 years. So this is the case that was then taken to the Labour Court, and the Labour Court upheld the position, and he challenged this and it escalated to the Supreme Court. Upon reaching the Supreme Court now looked at the same issue. And Justice Makarau, looking at this, this is what she had to say. It is therefore my finding that mere membership of a pension fund without other evidence tending to show that the parties agreed to import the retirement age as fixed by the pension scheme into the contract of employment is not adequate basis for holding that the age of retirement as fixed by the pension fund is the same as the age of retirement from employment. Makarau is simply saying we are wiser to make sure that we provide for a retirement age within the contract. Do not just assume that because NASA has it, it will automatically apply. The retirement that is in the NASA Act or in the pensions funds is a retirement in the context of contributing. So you'd have been making your emoluments, right? Is that the word, I think? Yeah, emoluments. So those contributions you make towards NASA, then you must retire from doing that in order then for you to mature and start claiming the retirement annuities that will be coming towards you. So you have retired as a contributor. So that is the context of retirement in that sense. It is not necessarily retirement from employment. So you can have a scenario whereby someone continues to be in active employment but is already enjoying their retirement benefit because they have retired as a contributor to the fund. And that fund has matured, so they begin to claim it while they are still in active employment. So we have a scenario with my employer has an even more interesting setup where you can retire on a family setup and on a family rate. So a family rate would basically say you are retiring along with your spouse if you are working for the same organization. So this particular spouse begins to receive retirement benefits and stops contributing towards the retirement because they have, because they have retired, as it were, to be a contributor, even though they are not yet 65. So the other spouse is the one who would be 65. But the one who is not 65 will begin to benefit as soon as they are admitted into the plan by virtue of signing to retire along with the husband. I hope this makes sense. So let me take that again. So in this case, I've had even NASA personnel say, as long as you're still employed, you cannot claim. So this particular 2018 case is instructive to say you can claim whether you're still employed or not, as long as you have met the requirements, you have retired. So the condition of retirement assumes a different meaning from not waking up and going to work every day. You are still retired in that sense. So this is one means by which you can go off the payroll. And the last one would be on grounds of mutual agreement. So on mutual agreement, this will be the last one, take home, as it were. This is where both parties are going to sign and say, we agree to part ways. People do not necessarily have to fight every time they go their separate ways. We can decide to say, hey, it's been good, cheers. And it doesn't necessarily even follow that someone will always have to be hard and fast and say, I need my notice period. You know, you could have a scenario whereby the employer can even waive that. I remember some time ago, we had a scenario, an employee, she is late now, I think, unfortunately. She got married and her husband was stationed in South Africa at the time. So she put in notice to resign, to go and be with her husband. We have a policy that promotes our families living together. So the fact that this person comes in to say, I want to go and join my husband. I'm now married. So do you really say to the employee, by the way, you must give me my 3 months notice, or you look at it and say, this person is seeking to be compliant to ensure that they order their life in compliance with a certain policy, the policy being no spousal separation. So when she then came over and says, I need to be with my husband, the employer waived the notice and said, oh, sure, you need to be with your husband. Go. It's okay. So you don't necessarily have to pull teeth and, you know, live with a long face. Let's learn to just say goodbye. Let people be able to move on. You need not hold a grudge. You need not be angry at someone because they're leaving. It's possible to do it mutually. And on mutuality as well, it doesn't necessarily mean because it's mutual, we do not document it. You need to document it so that you don't find yourself in a scenario whereby someone wants to go back and forth on an issue. There's a case I'm going to put down here. It's just immediately coming back to mind, where there's a gentleman who had done many years as well, and he found himself having to be retrenched because his post had become redundant, basically. So what these did, the company and the individual, what they did is they began to negotiate to say, your post has become redundant, we don't need it anymore. So let's start discussing what we are going to give you for separation. This is what we are proposing as an offer. The gentleman makes noise, no, this is not what I anticipate, this is less than what I look forward to. So what they did is they took this thing to arbitration. And when it went to arbitration, the first arbitrator looked at the whole thing and they said, okay, that's fine. So let's agree that whatever is payable here, we're going to say on the date of the award, that is your last day of pay, and this is what you're going to be entitled to. Having agreed to that and signed the agreement, this person gets the money paid out, and then at a later position comes back and says, nope, no, that particular whole thing was not proper. It should not have been done, because that should have been a retrenchment process. If that was a retrenchment process, therefore my last day, my termination must have been finalized at the point when the minister would have authorized the retrenchment. So because we did not have that authorization, so this whole thing is a nullity. And that was then pushed over to another arbitrator who was a bit overzealous, and he got to the conclusion that the earlier decision was a nullity. This was then escalated to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court basically said, what we're looking at here is a situation of mutual agreement. The parties have agreed, even though they have called it a retrenchment, loosely so, they have not followed the retrenchment process. They have done the termination in terms of a mutual agreement, and that is lawful. It is binding. So when we have agreed and we have signed, even though you have signed and said without prejudice, where you have agreed and you have signed, you cannot come back and then say, you know, that particular agreement that I had with you, I didn't agree. It doesn't work that way. So when we go for mutual separations, mutually striking someone off the payroll, you want to make sure you have documented it. It will save you a lot of hassles. It will save you a lot of problems because people tend to have selective amnesia. And some of these monies that come through or are paid out by companies, they appear like a lot when they are received, but they are not quite as much when you walk into the shop and begin to spend that money. It soon runs out and the person would want to come back for more. So you want to make sure as the business person you are, you have covered that and that door is shut. There is no way this person can come back to you. So what have we discussed as we come to the end of the employment contract? We want to take note that generally this is where the employer parts ways with the employee, resulting in a removal from the payroll. And for this person to be removed from the payroll, from the personnel side, it would be where someone has been dismissed or where someone has been terminated or where someone is incapacitated. And thirdly, it could be where someone has resigned. And fourthly, where someone has died. These are generally the conditions that would apply for someone to be removed from the payroll. Number one, termination. Number two, resignation. Number three, incapacitation. Number four, someone has died. And there are some actions or events that are going to predominantly lean towards the employer. So we've said where the employer transfers the undertaking. Should the employer transfer the undertaking and does not want to carry on the employees or does not want to pass on the employees, the employer must make sure that they have terminated the employees lawfully. So what about the lawful termination in this case? You terminate them by notice. You give them that 3 months notice and you go on in terms of the Labor Amendment Act, Section 12 of 2015, 4B, pay them the compensation for loss of employment. So it would be the 3 months notice, then the compensation for loss of employment, and then the vacation leaves that are due and the pensions that are due. Those must be paid. There is no way you can refuse to do that. You have an obligation to honor that. And in the transfer of this undertaking, these employees, as they move on, they are going to move on the same conditions that obtained in the previous undertaking if they are transferred to another, employer. This was the case in the Zinwa case where employees were transferred into the municipalities, especially those who were taking care of water. When water was decentralized and taken into respective municipalities, there were employees who were getting favorable conditions under Zinwa. When they moved over into the municipalities, the Gweru City employees began to make noise about that, even though they later on bundled their own case by litigating as a workers' committee instead of as individuals. But the issue is, whatever conditions obtained while they were employees of Zinwa were supposed to be carried over into their status as employees of the city of Gweru in terms of Section 16 of the Labor Act. And if there is no interest by the succeeding employer to take over the employees, you want to make sure you stop that flow. You want to cut that umbilical cord. And how do you cut that? You make sure that before you take up the undertaking, the outgoing employer must terminate all his or her employees lawfully before they become yours. Because if you do not do so, according to paragraph C, guess what? They are going to ensure that any rights that they had, which may have been infringed by the previous employer during his tenure, are enforced by the incoming employer. And these rights may be called upon for compensation from either the current employer or from both the outgoing and the current employer. And then we looked at five basic means by which a contract may be terminated. Number one, at the death of the employer. At the death of the employer, there must be 3 months' notice for contracts without limit of time that should be issued from that date going forward. And for those 3 days, these people must still continue to receive their salaries and benefits that would have applied while their employer was still alive. And then as far as dismissal, this one we looked at, every dismissal must be done in terms of a code of conduct. And secondly, besides being done in terms of a code of conduct, the burden of proof is on the employer, because the employee is already vested with the right not to be unfairly dismissed. And this same employee is going to be deemed to be unfairly dismissed should he or she be constructively dismissed because the conditions have become intolerable. And this has been intentionally done by the employee. And they will also be deemed to be dismissed where they had a legitimate expectation of being re-engaged. And at the expiry of the contract, someone else was re-engaged, actually. And then we also looked at number three, retrenchment. And on retrenchment, we're looking at a scenario where someone has to be retrenched for financial reasons or whatever the case may be. There are processes that ought to be followed, and ultimately the employer must pay compensation for loss of employment. 1 month's salary for every 2 years worked, and this will also apply to notices. And should the employer not be able to pay, the employer will need to prove beyond a reasonable doubt, convince the National Employment Council, the Retrenchment Board, of the inability to do so. And this inability to do so, as we did in collective bargaining, ordinarily will have to be proven using audited statements. And then this would also apply to notice periods, as I have mentioned. And then as far as retirement, upon reaching retirement, in as much as it is a scenario where the Labor Act is silent on discrimination in terms of age, this is something that must come in as a term of a contract, so that it becomes clear that someone is going to retire by this period. So that particular retirement age, in other words, becomes a limitation of time. So that contract would not be a contract without limit of time. And then lastly, we concluded on the note, it is not impossible for us to part mutually. We do not always have to fight. Let's be adults about it. And this is the reason why we've gone through this whole exercise, so that as we go in, you are able to cover the five R's of the employment relationship from a business perspective. How do you go out and recruit? How do you remunerate the people that you work with? When you have remunerated them, how do you renegotiate the conditions of your employment with them? And how do you then release these people from the contractual obligation? These are the items we have looked at in essence. And until we meet again in our next installment on consumer protection, may the Lord keep and bless you. Amen.